गुड आफ्टरनून, गुड आफ्टरनून ऑल द पार्टिसिपेंट्स। दिस वीक आईबीएस देहरादून इज गोइंग टू ऑर्गेनाइज कॉर्पोरेट लीडर लेक्चर सीरीज ऑन द टॉपिक व्हाट इट टेक्स टू सक्सीड टॉकिंग सक्सेस विद लीडर्स। एंड द डे वन टॉपिक इज मैनेजिंग ऑर्गेनाइजेशंस। सो विदाउट एनी फर्दर डिले, फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल आई वुड लाइक टू इन्वाइट आवर डीन सर, प्रोफेसर आनंद बेथापुरी सर, टू address these students. Welcome you, sir.
Greetings to all, respected our Honorable Vice Chancellor Professor Haragopal Reddy Garu, and also our Registrar Brigadier Raju Shetty, and my colleagues Dr. Kumar Saurabh and Dr. Puneet Gupta and Rashmi Chaudhary and Sanjay Malayaji and all my faculty members and my dear students. Really, it's a great pleasure and honor to invite today our eminent administrator and who has worked with the, a popular chief minister, YS Rajasekhar Reddy Garu. So today is our administrator, and he has been back of supported many institutions, BITS Pilani and IIT, IIIT. So he was with the chief minister, Dr. Prabhakar Reddy Garu. So I met him while he was in Krishna district as a collector to promote my software, Velugu software. So 2004, I met him in the Krishna district in the collector office. So really our students will definitely benefit with this corporate leadership and also interaction with the Prabhakar Reddy Garu, an IAS officer. So really it will give us a lot of, how they talk, what are their expenses. They're more than books. What I believe is, if an experienced person is talking with the students, it is more than hundreds of books. So I believe that today the students, please interact with the sir and try to get whatever the experiences are had within this 1 hour of time. So to become a good entrepreneur, or to become a good manager, or to become a good administrator, so or as a team member or a leader, so definitely this program, this series of 1 week program will definitely be useful. So tomorrow also we have one more guest from, he is a principal director of income tax, Krishna Kishore Garu. So like this, so definitely I believe that, so this lecture series will give a lot of inputs to our students, MBA students, to become a better manager. With these few remarks, and also I appreciate the efforts of Dr. Kumar Saurabh and Dr. Puneet Gupta. Continuously from last week, they have been coordinating with the office and IT department and resource persons. So I believe that it will be a great success. Thank you all.
Thank you so much, sir, for your kind words. Now I would like to invite Dr. Kumar Saurabh sir for introducing our respected guest. Sir.
Thank you, Puneet sir. I would like to invite Shri K. Prabhakar Reddy, retired IAS, to address the gathering. Shri Reddy was a distinguished officer of Indian Administrative Services. He held very prestigious posts during his tenure, including Special Secretary to the CM of Andhra Pradesh. Sir started his career in year 1977 and got his first posting as Divisional Officer in 1979. He grew from strength to strength along his career and was appointed as District Magistrate of Warangal District in year 2001 for 2 years, followed by District Magistrate of Krishna District for another 2 years. In 2005, sir joined Office of Chief Minister of Andhra Pradesh for 5 years. He worked closely with the then Honorable Chief Minister of Andhra Pradesh, late Shri Dr. Y.S. Rajasekhar Reddy. Shri Reddy was also the kingpin for establishment of BITS Pilani Hyderabad campus, IIT Hyderabad campus, Tata Institute of Fundamental Research Hyderabad, and Tata Institute of Social Sciences in Hyderabad, along with various other universities in the region. Once again, I would like to welcome you, sir, to address our students and the August gathering. Sir.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Good evening to all those people who are participating in this session. They may be placed, they're located in various places of this country, but due to this great technological innovation, we are able to talk to each other sitting in our own offices. Let me first thank the organizers of this seminar or this session for having invited me to say a few words. So, first of all, I want to draw a distinction between the audience and way high-handed, high work, because those who are now hearing me here on, in this session are people with business administration, that is MBA or the things connected with various business activities. Students must be getting their master's degrees in business administration are connected to that. Whereas I, as a Indian Administrative Service officer, my business was not with the business per se, but it is business of the people. When you work in a district as a district magistrate or a district collector, your goals are totally different. And whereas the business administration, they teach you how to handle your business or your organization and what are its goals and how you achieve the targets, whether it is marketing or production or sales or whatever you do, the section you are heading or you are supposed to work, your goals will be limited to your purpose. Whereas for us, it is all encompassing. It is pertaining to society. Secondly, your goal, this business administration, the target at the end of the day, at the end of the year, the balance sheet should show that you have achieved something big, or you have achieved what the management is expecting out of your efforts. It may be sales achievement, or it may be production achievement, or what inventory control, whatever it is. Whereas our goals, our targets are how much we achieved in society to the people, whether in the case of poverty alleviation, in the case of education, in the case of health, in case of agriculture. So these are the fields where we work as administrators. See, physically, when at the end of the year, if you take your balance sheet, it will be tangible results will be visible in your case. So how much money or how much profit you have achieved, how many production goals you have achieved, how your sales have increased. Whereas for us, it is called intangible. So you don't physically verify what has happened in the society. How many people were educated, maybe numbers. But really, how much of the education has percolated into the population is our target. Then how many people are being treated for their illness, or if they get into some health problems, how the hospitals are working, how the government is contributing for prevention of the diseases. Once the diseases are occurred, how to give them the health help. How to Medicare rather. So these are the things matter there, health and education and agriculture. And the same thing, we may be telling you that so many millions of tons of food production has taken place. But in reality, what actually happens is how many agriculture farmers have been benefited, how much the difference they've made, this year, how much they were producing and next year, how much they are producing. And it's been increased. The increase is due to what? Is it because of technological innovation? Bringing technology into the agriculture sector, or using machinery, or using improved seeds, or also like that, there is vast difference between the business administration as well as public administration. So in business administration, you have your targets clearly mentioned, and you have your people who are working for you. And the area, whatever the little area you are working, there are demarcated. Whereas for the public administration, when it comes to the general administration for us, it is a vast area, a district or a state, sometimes it may be a country. So we have to handle different vast areas as well. People are also heterogeneous. So heterogeneous because you will find different types of people in a district. Some people in one area, some people in another area, they may speak one language or they may have the cultural differences, they may have area differences, and so many things. The habits are different. Whereas for you, your set of people who are working for you, who are working with you, are clearly you know who, because you have recruited them, or your company has recruited them, or your organization has appointed them. So there is a homogeneity in your people who are with whom you are working. Whereas for us, it is heterogeneity. We don't know who are all the people, because once we go into take up a job, the people are already there. Who are in different sections. There are doctors, there are teachers, there are agriculture graduates, there are industrial. So like that, you are all the heterogeneous groups. You have to handle them. So you handle them, and you achieve the goals. So they achieve. At the beginning, I told you the goals are. For you, it is tangible goals of profits and the production, something like that. Whereas for us, it is intangible. So you have to mobilize, you have to support, and you have to motivate the people working under you or with you, and then achieve the targets. The targets, see, I told you in the beginning, that for an administrator in a district, the targets are even in a chief minister's office. So the chief minister will have the same thing. He will have to formulate the policies towards the health sector, health security, food security, and education, then land order also. So many things are there. He has to formulate policies and formulate the procedures to be implemented, and then implement them, get them implemented. So the goals are sometimes, for you, it is 1 year or 2 years targets. Whereas for us, it is it may be a generation. How previous generation and this generation, the literacy has improved, the health has improved, are the household living conditions are improved, are the their incomes have improved, are their behavioral pattern. For example, there are so many habits in the society. People at one point of time they are appreciated, but at another point of time they will not be. For example, you know that all of us know that in earlier days, they used to have chained marriages. They used to have multiple number of deliveries. They used to have no vaccinations. So that has changed now into small family norms, are the beautiful houses, and the increased agricultural production. And there are so many hospitals and medicines and vaccinations for the health and education. There are high technology institutions. So like that, when the one generation to another generation, our target is how the particular 10 years period of time or 20 years period of time, we bring about the change in the society in all sectors which we handle, like I mentioned in the earlier case. Simultaneously, we have to have how to increase the productivity of these productivity vis-a-vis the incomes, the jobs and the incomes of the people. Only when there is substantial increase in the incomes of the people due to efforts of the government or administrator at the district level or state level or country level, then only there will be improvement in the quality of life for the people. How to get that improvement in the income levels? That income levels will be input for various facts. You should have infrastructure, you should have job opportunities, you should have industries, you should have so many things will make the people get employment. Once they get employment, they get wages and salaries. And then where they stand and where the next level they go and how their lives have been qualitatively as well as quantitatively improved to make a better living. So these are all the efforts of the administrator in the public sector. So whereas you do the same thing, but the administration at the end of the day, we have to have the immediate goals or long-term goals. When you are working in an organization, you have a set of goals decided by your board of management or your general body or your boss. So he will tell you that, look, this is where we stand today. These are our achievements in this year. And I expect you, with this your team of people, to reach this level. So to reach that level, you have to plan your strengths and weaknesses, and then you go ahead. While doing so, you have to be, have some quality, and in you must imbibe some qualities, or you must cultivate some mechanism in you first. How to motivate the people? So motivating people will be possible only when you become a model. you must be a model to the people who are working with you, who are going to achieve targets with you. So that model in you will be the motivating factor for you. For example, when I was working as a district magistrate, I will tell all the people, you work hard, you must work by full time, morning till 10 to 5 o'clock without break, you do this, that. But that will not help them, help me or help the people to work hard. What happens is, they will look to me, whether I am working that many hours, whether I am working that long, whether I am working the same amount of effort I am putting. Normally, there are differences again. An administrator like you, a business manager, or the business administration, what you have a limited exposure. You are not exposed to politicians, you are not exposed to the public, you are not exposed to the press, unless you want it, you are not exposed to any other factor except your office, your company. Whereas with a public administrator, he's exposed to all these things what I mentioned. There will be politicians watching you, there will be press watching you, the public watching you, your subordinates watching you. So in their watching, while watching you, they should know that what you are talking and what you are behaving. Are you talking, are you asking us to work and are you working? Are you putting in a good number of hours of work in your daily efforts? That if I do that, then that message goes to me. Then people are also will be motivated. Secondly, the transparency should also be in case of your leaving. For example, in public sector, you know that there's a lot of talking about corruption. So people say that all the government employees, all government administrators, they indulge in corrupt practices. So what we say normally as an administrator, we say, no, you should not indulge in corruption. You should not, you are being paid to work for the people. So when that is the case, you should desist from accepting any gifts or accepting any money or accepting any corrupt practices. But at the same time, you must be able to adopt yourself. That you must be a model, that you are not corrupt, you are not indulging in bad practices, you must be a model to people. Without your telling, without asking them to be honest, you must be honest first. So it is like you are a model in case of honesty and integrity. Once you are honest and integrity, I told you that people know what is your, I'll give an example. When we work in the districts, the big bungalows we occupy, as the collector's bungala, they call the DC's bungala, or whatever people know. Those who do not have doors, you can jolly well live in a house where the entire thing is open. That means you are where you are living, where you are sleeping, and where you are eating, where you are doing almost the privacy maybe for smaller things, personal things. But generally, these bungalows are all full of people. Who move around, who keep around. So they keep track of your movements, your habits, and your honesty or integrity, how you are doing, and how you are living, and what are the things that matter. They are communicated to subordinates, or they are communicated to the people who are working with you. They get enthused. Yes, my boss is like this. He is not only talking, but he's not preaching, but he's practicing. So that message should go to the people. So you should be transparent, you should be honest, and also you should have human touch. So in any organization, whether you are working with 10 people, whether you are working with 100 people, we work with 50,000 employees. I am a collector of Varangal or Krishna, there are the different sectors. You are the head of all the sectors in the district, all the teachers, all the engineers, all the doctors, everybody will have a hierarchical setup. At the head of the pyramid is the collector. So when you are so many sectors or so many different departments, officers in the district coming to the tube, not only anywhere above 50,000 people of different sectors, different departments, they're all being headed by you. So you are the model for those people. How to be, when I said motivation, as not only preaching but practicing in your own daily life, you should also have human touch. So what we tell you is, you must be always open. You must be always receptive. You must always be able to invite the people to talk to you. You must always be ready to hear the problems, or whether it is people's problems or your staff problem or whatever. You must be open. You cannot close yourself and say, okay, I am big boss and I am sitting in my ivory tower and I will not talk to people. I will only pass orders. That will not work. Whatever may be your location, whatever may be your position, wherever you sit, you must be open. You must be available to the people. Your subordinates more particular. Once your subordinates think that you are accessible to them, you give your ear to them to hear their problems. You are lending your ear to them, and you are approachable. These things matter. They will think, yes, my boss is there to take care of us. He will take care of our problems. He will take care of our issues. He will take care of my. So that confidence will come only when you have human touch. You are able to talk to them. You smile at them. You pat them. So these things, if you adopt in private business administration or public administration, that will motivate the people. So when you are as a model, you should be having a fatherly approach or a human touch. That will be able to give you the thing which make the people work more than what their capacities are. And at the same time, you should be able to plan, and you should be able to foresee, and you should be able to think that I will be, my targets are like this. For example, you say that in this district, all the children in the 10th class, we say that we handle the school leaving certificate exams. So we will, one example I will give you. So all the girls, more particularly in the rural areas, the education is very important. Very important for two reasons. One is they get educated. That was very poor in those days, in earlier days. Now all the girls and boys are equally trying to go to school, because they used to have 5-6 children. Now only one or two children now. So naturally, every child is going to school. And admission is 100% in any area today. So once the children are there, more particularly the girl children, if they cross the school, they will enter into intermediate or degree. Then there are so many social factors will take care of by themselves. Social factors in the sense, if the girls are educated, the family is educated and people stay. But in addition, before that, if the girls are educated, when they are in college, they are in professional courses, their marriage will not be in urgency. Otherwise, what happens is when the third child is not married, and the girl child is not in school or college, when she's at home, the parents immediately think of her marriage. It may be at the age of 15 or the age of 14 or the age of 16. We want normally a child to be a girl or boy should be married after 20-21. But here, because the girl is at home, the village tendency is you marry her off. So that is child marriage syndrome. Secondly, once a child is married and she starts delivering children, her health and her children's health will not be good. So a child or a girl or a boy should be reasonably developed before they start producing. So that will not be achieved if the kid is not in school or college. So we insist on all the good education, all the children in school, all more particularly girls in school and colleges. Then the automatically the child marriages will not happen in the rural areas. Secondly, the health factor. Once you are educated, you are in a college and all those things, you will get more knowledge, worldly knowledge, and what is health and what is hygiene and what is vaccination or what is society, the environment, and all these things will come to you only when you are exposed to the in the college or school in a professional courses. These things will make you a full man or a girl. Then you will be able to understand the value of all these factors. So you will have a society with the people with the knowledge of about health, environment, and so many other factors. So that is the long-term target. I start working for the children in school to the maximum. So what we need to do? We have to have good schools. We have to have good school buildings. We have good teachers. And the teachers must be able to attend the classes. The teachers must be able to teach the children. And the teachers must ensure that their children appear for the school final exam or intermediate exam. And they should maximum number of people get through and get into the next stage of college, intermediate, or professional colleges. So that is the, as far as education is concerned, that's what we aspire for as administrators. In a, as district law, we try to take care of all the school education or college education, whatever. So we try at every sector, that is teachers, schools, books, or even food, and also done. And sometimes you with these poor people, more particularly the lower segment of the lower economics. I don't take the caste factor, but the poor people in the village, in any village, rural area, they will not be able to send their children to the school, to the college, because it's a bit located a far away place. So naturally, what they need an accommodation and there is some place to live. So we provide them hostels. So these hostels also should be adequately provided for. That means they should be able to live in a better place. They will be able to have the daily course taken care of. They will be able to get good food cooked and served to those children who come from the poor families. So the hostels also make a big difference in the children's education. So these factors, one after the other, once you are tackling in the society, in the district, you ensure that that happens. Same is the case with health. Health also the same thing. You should have good primary center, two secondary sector, hospitals, and district headquarters hospital. But in primary health centers, they will have a small staff, one doctor or one nurse, something like that. It's once a group of villages will have one PH, primary health center, or PHC they call. Then there will be an area hospital in the mandal headquarters, or the taluk headquarters, then district headquarters. So as the ailment is serious, then they will go to the next hospital. For that, we should ensure that the doctors are available, the hospitals are available, medicines are available, the beds are available. So when we ensure all these things, naturally the healthcare will be taken care of. Same thing, see, you may be asking why are they relevant to a business administration? So in your administration, whenever you think of executing any target of your company, you should have the plans like that. You must have systematically where it starts, where it ends. So when once you plan it in systematic way, like I said about the hospital, doctor, medicine, building like that, you should have your if you are in production level or even sales or marketing, whatever, you must be able to identify the areas where you have to involve and how to motivate and whatever the target you will be able to achieve at the end of the day. For this purpose, you have to have systematic planning. At the beginning, you should have your the way you show off yourself to the people and how to motivate. Once you are in place and you are motivating, your people are ready to work, you should have these targets. They are one after the other. You must be able to propose, you must be able to plan, and you must be able to execute. Execution, because our role is, big role it happens is the human involvement. The how we motivate, how we extract, how we make people work. For that, again, the same thing, they will be looking to you for their welfare first and their activity, their service for the organization second. So for this leader at the top must be able to show the people the way, how to reach the targets, how to achieve the goals, what are the goals, and that's clearly defined. So then your role in your circle, your area of operation, you must be able to achieve. And then once it is achieved, the cumulative effort will be the final result at the end of the organization. So when we have the achievements in health sector or in agriculture sector or industrial sector or in road sector, wherever there will be micro level to macro level. So like that, you have to organize things. Once you organize both men and material, you will be able to achieve your goals. Any failure in any part of this structure, what you have in front of you, you will not be able to, because there will be jumps, there will be jerks, you will not be able to have smooth sailing and smooth achievement of your targets or to achievement of your goals. So like that, you must be able to plan, execute, motivate, and be a model. And also, you must target what is your achievement. So I told you, when I go to the district, I want this district well connected by all roads. then I should know which are the roads which are not existing, which are the places which are not connected, and where from I get my resources for how to execute those things, including even sports activity. I remember when I was in Warangal, we have, there are no sports infrastructure at all, but you must be able to, because sports also are matter. Till now we have neglected. That's why in spite of our 130 crore people, our medal tally in Olympics are very poor. For simple reason is, we have not put as much effort, as much importance to sports activity. So like that, there should not be any sector which should be neglected. When you are in an organization, in a business or in a company or in a big establishment, you should never neglect any part of your activities. So there is a human and overall development of your human resources, then only your achievements will be full. Otherwise, there will be some dragging somewhere. There will not be any smooth movement of people. So when you achieve this, you know the targets, you know the people, you define your goals, then you will be able to be successful in your activity. You will be able to achieve the enough amount of profits to your organization, amount of sales in your organization, enough number of production, whether you are production line or other type of things. So your targets can be met once you achieve this, one or the other, the steps you have I enumerated now. But for example, I will give you, you may ask me, am I telling the things with my experience, or am I telling you from the bookish knowledge? I can confidently say that I have by and large tried to do these things in my career, more particularly when I was getting the district. Well, I'll give you one or two examples. When I talk to you about the education, the school education, there are 23 districts in Andhra Pradesh in those days. Now it is divided into two states, Telangana and Andhra. Those days there was 23 districts, and Warangal, with all its problems, because Warangal is the district which is fully infected by Naxalism, the left-wing extremism. There were Naxalites and law and order problems. They were blasting the police station. They were blasting the people. They were killing the people. So many things were happening when I went there. So at that point of time, I thought of the rural area is very backward as far as education is concerned. So I decided to improve that. And believe me, during those 2 years, my district stood first in 23 districts as far as 10th class and school leaving certificate children are concerned. But simple reason is, we used to sit with the headmasters, we used to sit with the teachers, we used to move around and interact with them. And we also sat with the welfare officers. Yes, I was talking about the poor people hostels, welfare hostels. Those wardens will be there for each hostel. So sit with those wardens, motivate them. And believe me, some of the poor the tribal hostels, they achieved 100% passes, 100% first classes in one school. I remember there is a place called Parvatagiri near Warangal. The 42 girls from tribal families. Tribals, we all know that they come from very remote areas. They are hardly first generation of children in school. Their parents were totally illiterate, totally uneducated. Those children too, they achieved the target of first class in the standing, achieving first classes in their 10th class and intermediate. So this can be possible. This was made possible by my effort along with other staff or teachers or wardens in the headmasters in the district. And also, I'll tell you, we have built one bridge. So people from South India or people from Andhra, they are there in the, among this today's participant. There is a big tribal fair in Warangal in Andhra, in Telangana today. For the organization, so whenever even organization of any big fairs like Kumbh Mela, like Pushkar, these things, it is again the headache of the district administration. The officers have to plan, execute, and the process, the procedure, the entire system should go smoothly. They have to put everything in place, people and men and machinery or whatever. There, so that the people who come there, pilgrims who come there for puja or for bath or whatever, they should not have any hindrance They should smoothly, the flow should be unhindered, and there should not be any obstacles, as well as there should not be any health problems, there should not be traffic problems like that. So for that, I needed to have a bridge across a small riverlet in one of the fairs. So this fair comes once in 2 years. So every collector will not be there for more than 2 or 3 years. So he will have one fair conducted during his tenure. So he will say that, hey, the bridge would have helped me. So he will ask the government to permit him to build a bridge. Then they will say, yes, by that time, this fair will be over and he will leave. So that is happening for the last 30, 40 years. So when I went, I determined to construct the bridge. That bridge was estimated in those 20 years back about 2 crore rupees, about 110 meters. So I had hardly 60 days to complete a bridge. And believe me, normally a bridge of that size in government will take minimum of 2 years to construct. And that too in a very, very remote area. It's a reserve forest, full infested with the wild animals as well as Naxalites. They don't want to construct the bridge. In that critical situation, can you believe I constructed a bridge in 37 days flat. Beautiful bridge in 37 days, concrete bridge we built, and the rest is history. Today, the fair is conducted with lakhs and lakhs of people assembling there without any hindrance in their movements, without any problem. So what I mean to say is, when you have a target to achieve, when you have a goal, you see, my idea was, I should have a bridge, I should have smooth flow, I should make everything convenient for the pilgrims, for the people who come there to offer prayers to the goddess, whatever their beliefs are. So for them, it is my responsibility as district administrator, district head, to create that environment. So we achieved it. There is no going back on that. Similarly, we have done so many places. I give you an example. You all know P.V. Narasimha Rao. P.V. Narasimha Rao comes from that area. He was our ex-Prime Minister of India. So his village is located nearer to that place. There's a place called Ajamnagar. It is 27 kilometers from any bigger town. There was no road. He tried to construct a road when he was Prime Minister of India, but he could not for various reasons, because he was sitting in Delhi, but he was not able to motivate the people in Warangal or in Karimnagar district. But believe me, I did it, and 27 kilometers road I laid. What I did is, instead of giving it to a contractor, to a big contractor who can take all machinery men and then and lay it, which will never be permitted. Naxalite will never let him come. Naxalite will blast away his machinery. What we did is, we motivated the local women. So I sat with the women. I talked to them. Look, you need a road. You need a road to send your children to school. You need a road to move your sick people to the hospital. You need a road to take your products, agricultural products, whatever, to the market. If the road is not there, you will be at disadvantage. Your children, we don't want to go to school, but there is no road. How can we walk through so much distance and riverlets or canals and those things? And when there is some sick people, I believe me, a pregnant woman need to be shifted to a PHC. They just could not shift because there was heavy water flow going in between the village and the PHC. And the pregnant woman could not deliver, and she is no more. So these things happen. So you try to inculcate, tell the women groups, sit with them and tell them, look, when a road is laid, you get your school access, your health sector, your primary health center, or hospital access, your market access, and so many things you can access because of the road. If that is done, then the group said that you pay, give us money, we will lay the road. And we formed the groups, and the women were paid the money, and they laid the road. And nobody could stop them. Naxalite could not go to them. If they go to them, they will question them. What the hell you are talking? We are laying a road for ourselves, not for government, for police, or anybody. So why these things matter in an administration? There will be a lot of difficulties in executing or in achieving the targets, even in the business administration also. When everything is smooth, the leader has no big role to play. But when you have competition, when you have somebody else producing the same similar product, what your company is producing, and how to sell it, or how to access your raw material, how to access raw material at the competitive price, or how to establish supply chain, or how to establish the deliveries. So many things are there in your administration. Similarly, we have in your public administration this type of things, and we decided and determined, and we achieved. So, for example, in another district, Krishna district also, we had the similar issues in villages where half-done things are there. We achieved in 600 villages. We have executed in a critically stopped projects. Like that in the village, you need some small road, small bridge, small school room, or some PHC building, or some market yard, or primary this cooperative society building, or a godown. These things required that will change the entire system in the village. So for that, what there was in government, you know, there is budget. They give you, okay, this school building, we will give you 2 lakhs. But by the time you sanction and you execute, there will be price differences and you will not be able to complete the building. So most of the government structures are half done. Last mile connectivity will not be there. So what we did is we are able to market those assets and brought them into use by a little interventions, a little contribution, a little money spending. All those assets in about 600 villages, we are able to bring, and the people are happy about it because the asset has come into operation. An overhead tank started supplying water, a primary health center supplying accommodating the nurse and the doctor, or a school building has got a decent sitting place for the children, or a market yard where farmers can go and sell their product, or the godown where they can store it, or a small industry or cottage industry in the village, where they can be able to access their, for example, weavers, or potters, or goldsmith, or ironsmith. These people have some small linkages which will enable them to jumpstart, get more income than what they were getting earlier. That is our target. So always you make a difference. Try to make a difference. To make a difference, your motivation, your efforts, and your carrying the people along. And at the end of the day, how you behave as a model, and your life, your behavior, your hard work, and the way you treat the people, all this matter, and you can achieve any target. There is no impossibility in any organization, whether it is a district with 50,000 employees or 1,000 villages, or a state with 8 crore people and 23 districts. So, you see, for all of us, our area of operation depends on the where we are handling this situation, where we are sitting, what position we are holding. Like that, if you do, naturally, whether it is the business administration or a company or a production unit or a sales unit or whatever, you will be able to get your targets of your profits or your balance sheet. At the end of the day, will show you, yes, what your board of directors or your management wanted you and what you have achieved. And what the various ways you adopted to reach that goals or achieve those targets, that will be same whether it is Indian Administrative Service or Master in Business Administration heading an institute. So like that, there are so many issues, because it's multifaceted. As I told you at the beginning, You are lucky to have homogeneous people, whereas we have heterogeneous and vast areas and vast people, different cultures and different languages and different areas, all those things. But still, the leader at the head of the organization matters. If he decides and he determines, he can. So you as a head of an organization or a department, if you are determined, you can always find the ways to achieve targets. Thank you.
Sir,
thank you. Thank you so much, sir, for your enlightening session. Now, I would like to invite Dr. Kumar Saurav sir to conclude the session. Sir.
Thank you, sir. At the end of the
Sir.
You
can take some, you know, chat box, some students, any doubts are there, any administrative, they can talk to direct, sir, for a few minutes.
So all students, those who want to interact, they can post their questions on chat box. Students can post their questions on chat box. Sir, we have one question from Ariana Mukhopadhyay. She is asking, I guess motivating those local people was not easy. So how exactly you motivated them to build the road?
See, before we sit with them and try to talk to them, they already know that they are finding problem to reach the urban area. Because there are nowadays, everybody knows that there is a thing called school, there is a thing called hospital, there is a thing called market. It's not that they are not aware of, but they know because there is no proper road, they are not able to reach those things. They are not able to take the services of their, a doctor or a teacher or a market yard. So these people know it. And I tell you, I give that example. When that woman was to deliver, she was in a critical situation and everybody knows that she needs to be taken to a hospital. Because normally in villages, the deliveries are done by local women. There used to be some midwives, they call them. Those midwives handle the deliveries. Maternal mortality or infant mortalities are very high because they were not hygienic and so many problems are there. Whereas if the delivery is in an institution, that's what we promote these days. That is by a medical professional. They will handle the situation and they will give vaccinations and all those things. So, but because there is no road, they were denied of this facility of getting a delivery by a medical professional, doctor. But they know that had there been a road, we will be able to go to the hospital with the woman who is to be delivered who is in a critical situation. So, and the same thing with the school children. Most of the girls will not go to school because there is no nearest location. Boys will try to go. So they know the value of the road. That situation you have to capitalize. Once I come to know that there is a place, they don't have a road, and they know that the value of road, then you sit with them. Look, I want a road not for myself. Normally in Naxalite areas, problem areas, they don't want a road to be laid. Because if the road is laid, the movement of police, the movement of government employees will be more and they will be able to catch them. So to avoid that, they will not permit you to lay the road. They blast the machinery, they blast the roads, they put the landmines under the roads to kill the people like that. So that situation, they will stop this movement to go ahead with the roads. But you sit with them, talk to them. I used to sit with them. I laid like roads like that in remote areas. There is a place, I talked about Ajamnagar. There's a place called Tupakal Gudam. The Gudam means a village with guns. That village was 9 kilometers away from a PHC. There was no road. There was no chance of the sick people to reach the hospital. There was no chance for the school children to go to school. That place, I went and sat with the women and I half day I spent with them. I talked to them. They say, yes, sir, we know that. We don't know how to get the road. Now that you are giving a way out for this problem. So you give us money and we execute. They did it. 9 kilometers road. Road was a beautiful road. Is like, when I went there, I had to walk 9 kilometers from the nearest primary health center to that village without a road. When next time when I went there, they say, sir, we are having the road transport bus today, every day and night. Even if there's a critical situation in the midnight, we can put the patient in the bus and reach the primary health center in 10 minutes. So that is the difference we made. That is, they perceive it. Once they perceive it, they accept your motivation.
Thank you, sir. On the same line, sir, another question being asked by Sweety Kumari. She has asked how you have motivated rural people to enroll their girl child for education.
I told you earlier days, in villages, the life span was 45 years for all the people. And for women, it is less than. And earlier, it used to be a lot of infant mortality, lot of maternal mortality, because the deliveries were handled by the village. They are hardly trained. They are not very hygienic way of handling the deliveries. So this mortality rate was very high. And the villages used to have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, like that, but they used to have children in every family. Now, because of the improved health accessibility, because of the improved knowledge, and because of the motivation of the government, and because a lot of lifespan also has increased, so many factors brought in the small families. So all the parents, by and large, as far as my knowledge goes, particularly in South India or places, which one or two child now has become very common. So one or two children are there. The parents are going out of the way to send the children, whether it's male or female, to the school. There is no going back on that. Earlier days, ladki ko education is not required. But no, now all girls and boys are treated well and treated equally. They are being sent to school. The only disadvantage or advantage is the school must be nearer, the school must be accessible, the school must be girls friendly. If that the girls friendly, if that you are able to provide that facility, there is no distinction, there is no discrimination between a girl or a boy.
Sir, I have one question. Like when there were no roads or less number of roads in rural areas, then how those schemes like Pulse Polio Abhiyan and all, how you have executed these kind of schemes to and making sure that it reached to the poorest, to the poor and the remotest area of the society?
Pulse Polio, these programs, they are once in a while. But they are not day to day and every day activity. So on that day, what we do is, okay, we were like for elections. You know that all the elections are conducted in remote areas also. We open polling stations, we send the polling officers, who is polling boxes or electronic voting machines on a jeep or individually, or three or four or people in a boat or in a motorcycle or something, we reach them, complete the job and come away. So polio also something like that. But not every day. See, the road, if it is there, every day it is required. They have to go to a market, they have to go to a school, they have to go to a hospital, they have to go to whatever they need to do, they need a hotel, they need a road. Whereas polio and elections and all these things can one day appear. On that day, we will ensure that we request acquisition of all the jeeps or car available in the mode of transport and put them on use and reach and come back. So polio is also similar operation.
Like nowadays, like vaccination, that COVID vaccine, this is also in the same phase, like it has to reach to everyone. But maybe at some places, infrastructure is not supporting.
Though no, it is again, see, one good thing happened nowadays. We are the power connections. Electricity is almost reaching all nook and corner of this country. That is one of the biggest achievements of this country in India. So when power is there, the televisions are reaching them. But we except a few remote areas, the televisions are making a big impact on the lifestyles of the people. So if we have a television in your house, you will be able to know what is happening around the world. They know that there is a corona. They know that it is a disease which is causing a lot of income world over. and they discovered that they have they are manufacturing a vaccine, and vaccine is to be will help you from prevent you from the disease. So this message has gone to every nook and corner. The only thing required is somebody must go and put the vaccine to them. So ask that somebody is the job of the district administration. So there are, you must have heard in northeastern states, they traveled one full day to reach a remote village, and they have given vaccination. So like that, the district administration has to do more than normal, walk an extra mile to reach the remote areas and then execute the vaccination.
Okay, Saurabh.
Thank you, sir. Yes, sir. Right, sir. So at the end of the session, I would like to thank our Vice Chancellor, Professor Hargopal Reddy, Registrar of University, Brigadier Rajiv Sethi, for providing a conducive environment to work and organize such lecture series for the benefit of our students. I would like to thank our Dean, Dr. Anand Bethapudi, for his constant support and motivation. I would like to thank our esteemed guest of today's session, Sri Prabhakar Reddy Ji, for his valuable time and thoughts shared with us. Sri Reddy Ji is a library in itself. It was worth listening to you since past 1 hour, damn reading 100 books. Thank you, sir, for your experience sharing. I'm sure our students must have gained a lot from this session. I would like to thank my faculty colleagues for their constant support. And I would like to also thank our participants, our students, for their participation and valuable questions. And last but not the least, I would like to thank our system admin for providing and making this session possible on this online platform. Once again, I would like to thank you all. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, sir. We end the session.
Parveen, now you can end the meeting.